You're listening to a Monster Kid podcast.
And welcome to A Dingo Ate My Movie, a podcast that features classic Ausploitation and other weird, wonderful, overlooked and underappreciated Australian films from the 70s, 80s and beyond. My name is Pete and I'm your host. Welcome to A Dingo Ate My Movie, a podcast about weird and wonderful Australian films from the 70s, 80s, 90s, and whenever. So today I am joined by Annette. She is a podcaster and a host of Two Crones and a Book and also the Stiletto Banshees. And today we're going to be discussing Snapshot from 1979. Good morning, afternoon, evening, Annette.
Hello to you, Pete, all the way on the other side of the world. My goodness, can't believe you're drinking whiskey at 7 o'clock in the morning.
And God.
I'm having a I'm kidding. And I'm having obviously just a hot milk and biscuits.
We weren't going to talk about that, but yeah, no, when we got on here and it had a nice, looks like a glass of nice white wine, which is her time zone friendly drink. And my time zone friendly drink this morning is black coffee. Yes. So anyway. So we're going to talk about this interesting movie, Snapshot from 1979. So the description I got from IMDb, I used to write my own, but I just get them from IMDb now because it's quicker and easier and I'm lazy. A naive hairdresser is spurred by her vivacious friend into becoming a nude model, but soon discovers that everyone she knows wants a piece of her. And don't they ever?
Just a bit.
I don't know what's going on with this film. She gets stalked by, I don't know how many people. We'll get onto it, but there's like the guy in the bar and then there's the movie producer guy who's the real villain, I guess. And then there's her ex-boyfriend who's a real villain as well.
And then we find out at the end another person who we didn't think it was going to be.
Just as a reminder, we're going to spoil the shit out of this. So if you haven't watched it, watch it first or just listen and then watch it. It doesn't really matter. So the cast for this movie is Chantelle Conturi and I can't remember the character's name. What was her character's name?
Mads Madison.
That's right. It was to Madison. And Sigrid Thornton was Angela Hughes Keys Byrne, who's in half of the movies I do. He plays the photographer guy and Denise Drysdale and Vince Gill. So it's an interesting cast. Mm. There's some real people, like I said, Hughes Keys Byrne. We've had in, like, we've done Mad Max Stone, Man from Hong Kong, Mad Max Fury Road, lots of movies he's done. Vince Gill, we've had him for Stone, Mad Max, and he was in Body Melt, weirdly enough. Chantelle Conturi was in Thirst, so I haven't done Thirst yet, but I think it's coming up. Have you seen Thirst? It's really good.
No, I haven't seen that
one. It's like a modern day, if a modern day was in 1979, 1980, vampire movie. It's very interesting. And Sigrid Thornton, who when I listen to the commentary, everyone just calls her Siggy, which is weird because in Australia, Siggy's slang for cigarette.
Yeah, it is.
But obviously they do it with an S. She's well known for the Getting of Wisdom, the FJ Holden. She was in Prisoner. I didn't know she was in Prisoner.
Yeah, that's actually the only place I know her from was from Prison Cell Block H. Right.
Okay. It's funny how it's called that there because I always knew it as Prisoner. I don't know if it's still, it's not still on, is it?
It was reinvented as Wentworth, wasn't it?
Oh, that's right. I remember that. Yeah. Yeah. Now, the crew is really interesting because the crew is like a who's who of Ausploitation in Australia, mostly. So we've got Simon Wincer, who is the director of Harlequin, which we haven't done yet, but I want to do that as well. He actually also directed Free Willy and Crocodile Dundee in L.A.
Not the Forbidden franchise.
Yes, I know. The Forbidden franchise, which I'm getting very close to thinking I'm going to do. I know, right? The film was written by Everett DeRoche, who wrote, oh my God, nearly every Ausploitation movie. He wrote Patrick, Long Weekend, Harlequin, Road Games, Razorback, Frog Dreaming, et cetera, et cetera. Cinematography was Vincent Monten, who shot Long Weekend, Road Games, and Thirst. And they're great movies, and Long Weekend's amazing looking movies. So that's a great one. Music by Brian May, not that Brian May, as we also have got. I've got these friends of mine that also do an Ausploitation podcast, and occasionally Bede and Marcy are on my show. And whenever I've always said, not that Brian May, and I think they're the same. It's always interesting when we do it. When I listen to one of the episodes and Brian May's the composer, they always say, not that Brian May, and I've always said, not that.
Yeah, that is definitely some merch in the future, I think you've got there, Pete.
I think so. Jeez, that's a great idea, actually. Yeah, Brian May is, like, quite prolific as well, like Patrick, Mad Max, Road Games, Turkey Shoot, Freddy's Dead, The Final Nightmare.
That's so proud.
And the other one that I didn't jot down in my notes, but I remember, was Dr. Giggles. Yes.
Love that movie.
I've never seen it, but anyway.
It's so stupid. I love it.
Is it? I love stupid movies, so I really need to see it.
Definitely.
It was produced by Anthony Ganane, who is Ausploitation royalty, I think. He's produced nearly every Ausploitation movie. He's produced Phantasm, Patrick, Thirst, Harlequin, Strange Behavior, Turkey Shoot, goes on. So this is like on the production side, this is a really who's who of Ausploitation. All we needed was Brian Trenchard-Smith in there somewhere and it would have been perfect. The budget was like $300,000 and there's I can't see anything that says how it went, but it didn't do well in Australia. But apparently it did quite well in the US and it did quite well in a few other countries. So interesting. Right. Yeah. And I think at that time when I was listening to one of the commentaries or reading something, I think it might have been Anthony Ganane saying that at the time a lot of Australian movies, especially like these genre movies and Ausploitation films, were not really popular in Australia with critics and audiences, but they actually found a home overseas, so it's quite interesting. Where to watch this? Well, it's available on Prime and Broly in Australia. So Broly, if you haven't heard, is pretty new. It's a streaming service that's run or owned by Umbrella Entertainment. So Umbrella do all the Blu-rays, all these great Ausploitation Blu-rays and all these other, they're a great distributor. And it's a brand new streaming service. This is an unpaid plug. Thank you. But it is really good. It's free, so it's ad-supported, so it's a bit like Tubi. But we watched the whole movie the other night on Broly and didn't get one ad, so it was really interesting. And it's actually really good. I'm not sure if you can get it from other countries. It might just be Australian, but VPN is your friend. And also, of course, Umbrella have a Blu-ray of this, which I have. It's part of their Ausploitation series that they have unfortunately stopped producing. They stopped at number 20, I think it was, but they were really nice packaged and had little extras. They still, when they release Ausploitation films now, they still have nice extras and stuff, but they had a nice slip case and they were very good. So, yeah. Where did you watch this?
I had a look around. You suggested Broly, but I couldn't access it and I don't have a decent VPN. Luckily, in the UK, you can actually get it on Shudder, but it's not regular Shudder. It's the Amazon Prime only Shudder.
Okay. Oh, that's weird.
I know, it's very odd. So I had to do a 7-day free trial so to make sure I got to watch it. But what's really annoying, Pete, is that after we discussed doing it, I found out that there's going to be, I think it's a Blu-ray or 4K release in the UK at the end of February.
Oh, right.
So that's out of ours. So in about a month's time from when we were recording, but it's got like some documentaries and things with it as well.
Okay. Sounds like so it might be I wonder who's releasing it. Do you know who's releasing it?
I don't have it off the top of my head. Sorry.
That's all right. I think, is it Broly have a, not Broly, Umbrella have some sort of relationship with one of the larger distributors as well? Is it not Vinegar Syndrome, maybe? I can't remember. But I know that they have some sort of relationship, partnership with one of those companies as well.
Right.
Yeah, interesting. But yeah, it's available pretty much everywhere.
If you hunt around, you'll find
You'll find it somewhere. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's good. The extras are great. It's got lots of interesting stuff. It's got a VHS cut. I don't know why they do that, but I actually think it's fun to watch like a really crappy pan and scan version of the movie. But it's nice because it's got the one that I have on the Blu-rays has been nicely restored and it looks really nice. Yeah. The other thing to know is this movie's also known by a few other names.
The names.
So it's known as One More Minute, which is a strange name, but I figured it out because there's a line right near the end where one of the villains talks about one more minute and it's about, yeah. And the other one is, weirdly enough, the day after Halloween, which
yes.
makes no sense.
Did you read anything about that, why they gave it that title?
Yeah, tell me.
Well, no, I read it was a Guardian article and they said that they named it that because it was a cash grab after Halloween being released in the US.
Yeah, the distributor apparently.
Yeah, and everyone was like, oh, come on.
Yeah, it's quite funny because I think it was one of the extras on the Blu-ray, Anthony Gaudet, was talking about it and was saying that when he sold it to a US distributor, they basically said, do you mind if we call it something else? And they wanted to call it the day after Halloween. And I think his response was something along the lines, as long as your check's good, the cash is in, I don't care.
I love it.
Yeah. He's an interesting guy. I think you're actually doing a whole episode on Anthony because he's done so many films and he's got some really interesting stuff he's done. Like he had this whole thing, like this movie was the middle of a 3-movie set. After this, they went on and did Thirst and they did it almost immediately after this movie. And they actually did some reshoots for this movie while they were starting to get Thirst together. It was really quite interesting. And so, yeah, so he's an interesting guy. And like I said, he's done lots of these films. He's produced lots of movies. He passed away a few years ago, unfortunately, but I hope he's dead, but I hope I'm not saying he's not here and he's still. I'm sorry. I might cut that bit out or not.
Save it.
If you're, anyway, Anthony Gaudet and your family, if you're not here, I'm sorry, but anyway. Yeah, he was fantastic, and I don't think the whole genre of Ozploitation would be around without him here or without him doing anything. Let's get on to the movie. It's a very strange movie. It's not strange, but it's just, I don't know. I've never been chased by a Mr. Whippy van before.
I mean, they've always been sinister, to be fair.
Yeah.
Ice cream van.
Especially when you hear them coming down the road with green sleeves playing.
Yeah, and just slightly peeking around corners at you.
Yeah. You get Mr. Whippy kind of vans in the UK, yeah?
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah.
Are they called Mr. Whippy or are they called something else?
No, we have Mr. Whippy and then there's varieties of others. Yeah.
Now it's all some trendy sort of ice cream stuff these days, but we still have a Mr. Whippy van coming.
Oh, yeah.
It's funny. I used to know this guy who was a real tight ass, and he used to tell his kids if you could hear the music, they were out of ice cream.
Yes. That's such a very classic. No, that's there's none left. None. Yeah, none left.
They're going back.
Yeah.
Yeah. In this case, if you hear the Mr. Whippy van, you're getting stalked, basically. I don't know why he would be so obviously stalking you playing music, though.
But I was almost disappointed when it turned out like it wasn't just the van on its own stalking her a la Christine.
Oh, yeah. That would have been good, actually.
That would have been fantastic. I was never driving the whole time. It was the van.
Oh, boy. So the driver of the van is her ex-boyfriend. Is it Daryl? Is that his name, Daryl?
Yeah, Daryl. Daryl.
And he just can't accept that she's broken up with him. And apparently, from what I understand, they had sex twice, and that's about it. And a date used to be her coming to her place, him coming to her place, and spending all the time talking to her mother.
I clocked the age difference. They got together when she was 16 and he was 27, even though he looked about 45.
Yeah, he did. He's got that friar's patch in the back of his head.
Yeah.
I shouldn't talk. I'm losing my hair. But he's an interesting character. He's really, obviously, it's Vince Gill who plays him. And it's interesting looking at Vince Gill. I don't know if you've ever seen, have you seen Body Melt?
No, I haven't.
So first you really need to see that movie. It's just nuts. And in that, he's completely like different because he's probably, this was in 79. I think Body Melt is 1990 something. It's very close to the 2000s. So he's a lot older and he's a completely different kind of character. He looks better in that. But in this one, he plays this, he's, I don't know, the guy, it's obviously the way he's been directed. He's quite a pathetic kind of character.
Yeah, but quite intense as well, isn't he, at moments?
Super intense. There's that whole conversation where he grabs her and he talks about something about if you put your hand on the side of a goldfish bowl or a guppy bowl, the mother will eat the babies.
And he has this very bizarre relationship with her family where you think the way he's manipulated the family to his side of everything, but at the same time, they're very willing to take his side in everything.
Yeah, they're a strange family. Like,
oh, they're odd.
They're really odd. We'll get to that. So the basic plot of the story is she's like this young hairdresser. She wants to leave the country and live overseas, and then she's totally, I guess, under the thumb of her terrible mother, who's right up there with Piper Laurie and Carrie, almost. Oh, look, take the deep breaths in it. It's okay.
Sure.
Yeah, take a sip. Take a sip, calm down.
And then she meets Madeline, who comes into the hairdressing salon that she works at, and Madeline comes in, and she's a bit of a diva, right? She's described as a glamorous model, so she's quite nice. Chantelle Conturi is quite nice to look at, and
she's gorgeous,
yeah. And she tries to pursue you know, a modeling career and whatnot, and Angela agrees, and they end up doing this shoot on the beach, and which is an interesting scene, and she ends up going topless. It's really weird. It's really weird. But, and the guy, what's the name? Lindsay, who's played by.
Yes.
Yes. He's an interesting character in this movie too, actually.
He's this obsession with photographing dead mice.
Yeah. Yeah. It's quite, he thinks he's got the market cornered. There's a whole conversation where she asks him why he photographs dead things, because apparently he does other animals as well. He's not just specializes in mice, but other animals as well. And he responds along the lines of saying he's got the market cornered in photographing dead things. But he plays the part really well. He's Kingsburn. He plays the part of this really eccentric photographer, artist guy really well, even to the point where at one stage, he's looking through photos or something, and for some reason, he's got his one leg right up on the table as he's. It's like really weird, but I think it's just he's playing. He's been told, like, this is all in the direction, I'm sure. He's told to play very eccentric, but he's a likable character in this.
He is. I really liked him. And when. What was it when she was seeing the final photo in the layout and she didn't seem to like it? I really felt for him because he looked so wounded.
Yeah, he did. He's a great actor, though. He's a very good actor. Oh, he's fantastic.
Fantastic.
He was. I miss him. Yeah, he's really eccentric, but really good character. Yeah, photographing dead birds, stuff like that. Interesting. So she goes and does this photo shoot and we get this great song by Sherbet, which we'll talk about later, but there's Angela's song that you can hear. Go on.
I was going to say, it was just so perky and light. It's like, you know, this girl has been convinced, you know, to take a top off. You know, it's meant to be, normally if you watch a movie, it's like, oh no, this is, it's yeah. quite dark and seedy. But you got this really catchy pop song and yeah. then old guy with a pipe is just the there old, watching.
The old purr. It's just, I don't know if he's a purr. He's just walking along the beach, right? And he sees yeah. this and he's, and I think anyone would stop and have a look what's going on.
Yeah,
and most people, I think, when they realize they're doing a photo shoot and she was topless, I'd probably just walk away and give them a bit of space and let them do their thing, right? But yes. this guy doesn't.
No, they shoo him away. Yeah. And then 5 minutes later, they turn around and he's back again.
He's just sucking on his pipe. Sucking on his pipe and watching what's going on. But it's a good, it's actually a good scene, though. It's quite, it's like a montage, of course, but, and the song's quite cool. But yeah, it's really good. Anyway, so she poses on the beach and for this, it's a perfume ad, right? In a woman's bag.
Yeah.
It ends up in Clio. Is it Clio? Which is a, it's really interesting. This movie, there's quite a few true to life things. I think it's Clio magazine because Clio was a women's magazine in the 70s and 80s. I don't know if it's still around now. Let me know. But so yeah, so then I think there's a scene where they go to a party and it's the one with that weird guy doing the singing and stuff, the cabaret.
Yeah, it's the, it's like the weirdest disco ever.
Yeah, with a floor show.
Yeah, like at the beginning.
It is strange. And that yeah. guy who pops up a couple of times, and apparently Sigrid Thornton knew him, and he was some sort of performance artist in Melbourne, and that's how they got him. They roped him oh. into the movie that way. But yeah, it's really quite strange. The first time I ever watched it, I think I saw this movie like back on VHS days, right? Back in the mid 80s, early 90s, or something like that. And I totally forgot about the scenes with him, with the cabaret guy.
Yeah, and it's weird.
It's so strange. And he does that thing with the weird side lip and...
Yeah, because he portrays these different different characters, doesn't it,
yeah.
throughout. It's, yeah, it's interesting,
it
though.
It is. Yeah, it makes for makes an interesting movie. But so, yeah, she goes to the nightclub, and when she gets home from the nightclub, she's been locked out of the house by her mother, who obviously doesn't like
for turning up...
For turning up late.
Turning up late one night and you get booted out at 4 a.m.
And she'd even change the locks.
Yeah.
How did she do that? Just called up a 24-hour locksmith and just got him out.
It's a minute past, quick, change it now.
So she ends up crashing at the studio, right, at the photography yeah. studio, which is a bit of a, it's almost like a bit of a commune because there's a few of them living there and it sounds like people just come and go. And I think Denise Drysdale's character talks about you just pay whatever you can afford and the people that are doing okay kind of support the ones. It's a bit of a commune kind of thing.
Yeah.
And it's an interesting place. Apparently it was shot, those scenes in the studio were shot in the main office of Mushroom Records in Melbourne. Mushroom
oh,
Records
wow.
is a pretty well-known Australian record label. And it was one of the first record labels in the country that, major record labels in the country in the 70s, and lots of great artists go through. They're still going to this day, I think. And yeah, so they shot those scenes and I didn't know that until I watched the commentary, listened to the commentary, but they shot those scenes in the offices of Mushroom Records in Melbourne. And then some of it, like her bedroom, I think Sigrid Thornton was saying it was in her father-in-law's some house or something that he owned or something like that. And it's really, I always find it interesting where they shoot things like this. It's,
yeah.
It's quite interesting as well. Yeah. So she ends up crashing the night at the place and gets a room, gets a mattress on the floor, and the mattress looks really dodgy. And some guy had been sleeping on it before. And anyway, so she seems to be quite happy there, though. She does all that sort of thing. And she's, yeah, that's when really weird things start happening. She starts getting stalked by all different people. There's a scene in the club where the one guy who turns out, now he's the guy that eventually offers a job, right, at the end of the movie. He's got, is it a, what company has he got? I can't remember.
is this some sort of, like some sort of like lawyer or something? He wanted to hire as a PA.
That's right, in Fiji. I think it was a Fiji or something, yeah. Which would be a nice place to go and live. And so, yeah, but he's really weird with her first. He's like touching her up, and then Madeline gives him a knee to the nuts.
Yeah, she grabs all of them,
oh, she
didn't
grabs
she?
It. No, sorry, not a knee. Yeah. She actually grabs them with it.
No, she's going to rip it up, this girl.
But we turn out, it eventually works out that Madeline has ulterior motives. She's got a crush on her, I think, because turns out later we find out that Madeline is a lesbian, and and she obviously is quite keen for Angela, and I think that's where a lot of that comes from. But also I think she's trying to protect her. I'm not sure, though, because sometimes I think she's almost complicit in a lot that goes on in this movie.
Yeah, it's like dragging her into that world. Was it all for a reason to get to that position at the end?
It's quite strange. Yeah, but she looks after her a bit, and she ends up being a bit of a sounding board for her and things like that. But yeah, she grabs the guy in the nuts, not in a good way. And that's quite, and the look he gets on his face when he grabs her, it's a bit of overacting, but it's funny. So then she ends up, tell me if I'm missing anything, right? Because then there's a few extra scenes with her and, I can't forget, Daryl, I think his name is, Daryl.
Yeah, it's Daryl.
Where he's comes around and he wants to know what she's doing there, and he comes looking for her. And then we get the scene with the mother, your favorite scene.
Coming, my God.
Finding where she lives and finding out that she's, because Angela earned $1,000 for this half-day photo shoot. And she's got it. It's so 70s, right? It's in a nice little envelope in the drawer. Keep $1,000 in an envelope. But anyway, cash is king, as they say. And, yeah, all right, then we get the scene with the mother. I think I'll let you run with the scene with the mother, Anna.
Yeah. So it's it. So she's come home and someone's just, this is when they're doing the pitch downstairs. For the advertising campaign, they inform her, like, there's someone to see you upstairs. And she's, okay, fine. She goes up and her mum's sitting on her bed. And, oh, my God. It's the most infuriating, gaslighty nightmare situation where I was literally off the chair shouting at the screen of this woman. The dog ran out of the room.
Oh, wow.
Oh no, I'm not staying for this. Yeah, it's in this conversation. She says she heard from Daryl and her little sister Becky why their relationship ended, and she didn't even ask Angela anything about it. So I'll just take it from them and not believe you.
Yeah.
And I'm getting riled thinking about it, and I can't even keep on. So she's obviously, like we said, she's kicked her out of the house. But she's the only reason she's come there. She knows that she's heard that she's earned some money, figured out she's earned some money, apparently, and saying that her sister Becky needs it. She's in the hospital. She's had an accident.
Yes.
And all this. And then, but then at the same time, she's saying, so you must be, she's assuming she's earned the money prostituting herself, I think, is what she's alluding to. Mm. But then it's all very, everything's Angela's fault. She's the problem, but oh, woe is us. Can't you help us? But it was like, it was changing from sentence to sentence. And you're like on this roller coaster of, oh my God.
Yeah, she's terrible. It's very, like I said, it's very like Piper Laurie and Carrie almost.
Yeah. And then like when she lets slip that she's noticed that she has $900. And she's like, how do you know I have $900? You've been going through my things. Is it? Quickly changes.
Oh,
the
she was
subject.
Looking for something or something like that. Yeah, she was looking for a piece of paper to write a note on for.
Yeah, a note on to say that she'd been there. Yeah, and then she even looks through the magazine where the picture is, and she doesn't even notice that Angela's there is in that picture for the advertising.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until Angela holds it up to it. This is how I got it. And that was the mother accuses her of being a whore and to never darken her doorstep again and takes off.
Yeah.
And then Angela has realized it goes to look through the drawer and the money's gone.
Yeah.
That woman, I mean, I probably missed massive chunks of that conversation because, as I said, I was so livid.
But it's such a dysfunctional family, right? Obviously. And her sister's a piece of work even.
Oh, my God. They're just awful.
And then, of course, it turns out that we find out later that nothing happened to her sister. She didn't end up in the hospital. She was taking her job in the hairdressers.
Yeah, she pinched the job.
Yeah.
And I was, no, that was one of those, no, I have to take a walk for a minute. No, I have to pause. I have to go, no, something else, distract me. I'm livid. My God, I didn't think I was going to have that kind of reaction in this movie, but oh my God.
Yeah, she's quite a piece of it, but I don't think we see her again after this scene. That's pretty much it. So,
no, but what a scene to
what
have.
A scene to
I mean,
have,
that,
yeah.
that was a masterclass in manipulation.
Yeah, yeah. She's a great actor, though. She was in, have you seen Patrick, the original one, the 70? No? That's okay.
I'm going through my movie list and I'm going to up my exploitation knowledge.
So she's in Patrick. She plays she's like the main matron of the medical center where Patrick is, like the hospital thing. And she's really good in that as well. She plays a really nurse ratchet nurse sort of thing. And
so she's perfected the mega
bitch. Very good at, yeah, she's very good at that sort of stuff. Yeah, so she definitely has an impact in this film. And she,
just a bit. I'm never going to forget her after that.
And then she visits this Elmer guy, right? He's the guy from the modeling agency and at this mansion.
Madeline's husband.
That's right. It's really weird. This is where I think Madeline is almost complicit because I don't know if Madeline set this up, like they have some weird relationship or something, like between her and her husband. Or is he estranged?
Yeah, because he's like a movie. No, he's a movie producer. And obviously, because she says earlier on in the movie, he does his thing, I do my thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So he obviously goes for these younger models and things like that. So it's, I don't know, maybe, I mean, I was probably giving away a bit much for the end bit, but maybe that was the whole idea that she could have her cake and eat it. Not only could she have this relationship she wants, but she also gets all of his money.
She gets told that it's going to be a barbecue with a whole lot of other people. And she turns up to the house and it's just him. And he even fakes a phone call from Madeline.
Ugh.
So creepy, right? He does.
Oh, I mean.
Yeah. I can't remember what the number is.
Another title. Sorry, I was going to say, Pete, another title for this movie with the 100 others could be the Red Flag movie because it is nothing but red flags.
Very much. I don't know why she doesn't see him. She sees him a bit late most of the time.
Yeah.
But otherwise you'd have no movie, I guess. But she turns up and he fakes a phone call. And when I was watching this with May, she was saying, I remember doing that, but I can't remember. She couldn't remember the number you used to have to punch in. There was like a certain number you could punch into your phone and then a couple of minutes or a few seconds later it would ring.
Yeah, it was like to test the line.
Yeah, and so he goes through and he does that. And he has this – and her acting is actually really good in this part because – when he's on the phone and he says it's Madeline, she turns around as anyone would, like when she hears somebody is on the phone that she likes. She turns around, she has this big smile. But she's very, I don't know, Angela's pretty naive, right? And obviously he plays it up really well with the phone call and all this sort of stuff. And then, of course, Madeline's not coming home and then he starts wanting to take photos of her. This is where we find out how creepy he is and... He first starts by saying to her, hey, here's a phone number of a producer guy or something and he'll be able to get you into movies and all this sort of thing. And then he gets his little Kodak Instamatic camera, which...
Oh, my God, with the flashes. Oh, my God.
That shows up a few times in this movie. It's really great. It's such a... For an older fart like me, it's like a nice flashback, all that sort of vintage stuff.
No, it's true. I remember going through the house. Obviously, I'm sorry, Pete, but I was born in 79. Sorry, I apologize. But I remember like my parents would have loads of old camera gear and finding flashes like that. What the hell is this?
What's this?
That's
Isn't it amazing how far we've come, right? We've come from these cameras where you actually plonk a flash on the top that only works once. Once you take the photo, you throw it away.
Yeah.
To having a thing in your pocket that you can shoot amazing photos with. It's unbelievable. And
we thought we were so fancy in the 80s with those long ones with the one little flash in the corner.
Oh, yeah, the long skinny ones. Yeah, I remember those, yeah. And the flash used to work all the time. But, I remember
That noise. I miss that sound of a flash. Boom, you know, once it's gone off.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And, he takes these photos with the Kodak film and the Kodak camera, and they all look a bit dodgy, and then he gets her to strip off a little bit more and a little bit more. And at first, it's interesting because at first she goes along with it, and then it dawns on her what's happening. And because he's done a good job to try and get her drunk, and he's such a creepy looking guy too, right? He's got the mo, but every man in this movie's got a mo just about. Must have been the season for it, the year for it. And mo's were really big in the 70s. My dad used to have a real bushy mo, and must have been
my dad did too.
Yeah, it was a thing. It was a thing. And, so she gets out of it by just leaving, basically. And he lets her leave. I'll give him that. He does let her leave. So,
good for him.
Yeah, good for him.
what a hero.
He's a bit different next time.
So
she gets away. And then this is when she get caught out. She gets home. Oh, there's a scene in this which I never picked up on. So we're coming into the scene where she gets home from getting this, being awfully abused by this guy with the photos.
Yeah.
To coming home and finding the pig's head in the bed, right? And when I first watched this, I was like, who put that there? And I was so stupid, I didn't even think. And it was when I watched it again the other night, there's this little cutaway scene while she's at Elmer's house getting the photos done and having dinner with him. There's a little scene where Daryl turns up to the place and asks where Angela is. And he's got slung over his shoulder, he's got a big duffel bag. And that's all in that scene. He just asks where she is. And then it cuts back to Elmer's house. It took me till I probably watched the movie three times to go, it's him. He's the one with the pig's head because he had it in the duffel bag. And he was.
So he lied then later. How could he lie?
He just, like everyone else in this movie, he just gaslights her, right?
Oh my God, just a bit.
That'd be a good name for this movie, is all just gaslight. But
at least we're throwing up with a list as we go.
Yeah. Yeah, so I didn't realize, because I used to think, first, I didn't know who tore up her dress. That's the other one. I don't know who did that. Could have been anyone. It's like everyone's after her for some reason. And
I thought it was going to be possibly Madison to make her think that this guy was worse, rather than just being the creepy gaslighter, that he was a dangerously stalky, I'm going to kill you gaslighter.
It could have been, yeah. I still could be wrong, but I don't see somebody turning up to the front door of a house asking where someone is and having a big bag slung over his shoulder. And a couple of scenes later, we're finding a big pig's head in her bed.
But then again, if it was Madison, she has free rein of that place because they all know her.
Yeah, that's true too. Yeah, they don't know him. But then we don't see if they said to him, she's not here, and he just says something like, oh, I've got something here I want to drop off to her. And because it was such an open kind of place, they probably would have been just, just go up to her room and leave it.
We could go over this for hours. Thinking about one little bit, one pig's head is causing so much conversation.
Well, the other thing, he could have kept that pig's head cool in his ice cream truck. So
that's true. Does it smell like ice cream?
That's right. Anyway, that's my theory. But for a while I was like, who left the pig's head? I don't know.
Yeah.
And I still don't
another
know.
Title.
Yeah. But the other one, I don't know. I don't know who tore up her dress. That one,
no,
I have no idea. Was it a mother? No, couldn't have been. It's really strange. There's a lot of things that are unexplained in this movie, which actually is not surprising because apparently the whole script was written in 4 days. I think it was written in 4 days by Everett DeRoche. Apparently he got his wife to help out. She's co-writer. And apparently he got his wife to help out to help him a little bit with the female scenes, to help him get an understanding of how they would act. I'm not sure if she gave him the right information or he just wrote it wrong.
But I like it. I like that it provokes conversation. I mean, I know it's plot holes and they're not really that bothered, but I think that's great because it does make you look into other scenes and create narratives that aren't there that could be there. And I think it does. It's part of the fun of watching a movie like this.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you don't know what's happening, where it's come from, who's doing what. And, so I don't know. Unfortunately, I'd love to find out. If anyone knows where the pig's head comes from, let me know. If you're out there and, I don't know, Sigrid Thornton, if you hear this, can you tell me, please?
And we love you.
Tell me where the pig's head came from, because I don't know. Yeah. I'm sure it was your boyfriend, but Annette thinks it could be someone else.
I think it's Madison. Yeah. I think it's Madison.
Yeah, it could be. So she finds the pig's head, and what does she do after that? Is that when she runs off and she goes to the club again? Because she finds she goes to find Madeline again. And is it in the club? Is she in the club scene? Yeah, I'm a bit fuzzy after that. But then she gets offered the job in Fiji by the other guy who was touching her up earlier in the movie.
Yeah.
And this is where everything starts to, I guess, accelerate towards the end. She gets the job offer in Fiji and then she's packing. She rushes home to pack. No one's home. She thinks someone's there, so she packs really quickly. And then she hears the sound of the ice cream truck.
The most sinister truck in the world. I loved it.
She's in there packing and you hear the ding, ding, ever. And she looks out the window and she can't see it. So she hears the truck and then she rushes off. She packs everything else in and she goes running. And as she goes the front steps, the front of the house, Daryl's right there, obviously, because we heard the truck.
Of course.
I don't know why he bothers us so much. Like, I know he's obsessed, right?
Yeah.
And he tells her he can't let her go and all this sort of stuff. And she just drops everything, like suitcases and all, and runs, which
she never goes back
for them, I don't think. But, yeah, and that's when she's got the little thing in the city. She runs into the main street, which looks like Lygon Street or something in Melbourne, and past all the old-fashioned shops there and into the phone booth with the old Telstra phone, and makes the phone call, rings up. She actually calls Elmer, doesn't she?
This blew my mind. I'm going to escape the creepy stalker guy by being rescued by the creepy stalker guy.
I know, right? And she could have just dialed 000 and got the police, but anyway.
Yeah.
But, so she calls him, and he says he's going to send a taxi for her, and the first taxi she sees, she gets into. I mean, was that the taxi he sent? I don't know. Must have been.
What a hell of a dial for 79. Bloody hell.
Yeah. And, of course, you can see the Mr. Whippy truck going up and down the street and he's turning around.
There was the peeking around the corner like it's looking for her itself.
I said to May, every time he pulled up in the truck, I said, wouldn't be people coming up to the window of the truck going, hello, can I get ice cream? Can I get ice cream? And he's like, oh, fuck, I'm trying to track all these people with ice cream.
Come on.
How am I supposed to stalk while you want ice cream? Anyway. She gets away from him and gets, inverted commas, rescued by Elmer by going to his office. And I don't know, he must have just organized this whole thing. Like, she calls him up. I don't know how he did it because he didn't know she was going to call, really.
No.
Unless he was in cahoots with Daryl, but I doubt it.
Can't see him.
And in the time between when she called him and she gets to the office, which I assume is probably less than an hour, he sent everyone home from the office.
The entire office is derelict. There is nobody there.
There's no one there. And he sent them all home. And she arrives in the office and can't find anyone and goes downstairs and walks into that room, which is actually one of the better scenes in the movie, where she walks into the room and he's got the whole room plastered with the photo from the ad.
Yeah, when Pete says plastered, he means like the floor and ceiling and walls is nothing but her photo.
This movie's creepy in some places. It actually gets a bit creepy here. And then when he comes in and he looks really serious and I'm like, okay, what's he going to do? I don't know whether he just wanted to, again, take photos of her or if he wanted to rape her or whatever he was going to do. I got a feeling it was probably the latter.
Yeah, it was definitely leading to that. It was a different kind of intensity he had.
Yeah. And so he goes to take more photos of her and she looks terrible, like she's terrified. And then he starts dousing her with, I don't know if it's, I'm assuming it's petrol or it's some sort of film stuff or I don't know what it is, but he just happens to have a can of it on a shelf.
Whatever it is, it's a flammable material.
It's a flammable material, exactly.
We'll go with that.
And he locks the door and he puts his little bit on the, he's very careful how much he pours on the floor. He's not, in some movies they toss it. He's like, well, just get this little bit, that's enough.
Just enough to scare you.
Just enough to scare you. I think that's what it is. And then he lights it up, but it goes. And then he puts it. Then she tries to get it from him, and in the struggle, gets
him. She tries to bolt out the door.
Yeah, and she's got the whatever the accelerant is. She's got it on her, and he's got it on him. And all of a sudden, he steps into the fire, and one flash in your ash, right? And does this great burn, and that's Grant Page, which is once again another Ausploitation alumni who's been in everything. He's a stuntman and he's done everything in Australian film in that era as far as stunts go, and he did this amazing burn. Apparently he was very careful when he spoke to Sigrid Thornton about where she was going to stand, and he went through everything about where to stand. And the reason she's so wet is this was one of the first times they used this, like a gel they put on them so they could burn. And apparently what would happen is you could burn, but you only had a certain amount of time and then you had to get put out because obviously you'd go through that layer and burn your skin. And so the reason she was wet, besides looking like she had this stuff on her, but she apparently had the gel on her as well, just in case. So then Elma gets burnt to the ground, basically.
Yeah.
And she's rescued, of course, by Daryl.
What a hero.
I don't know how he found her there.
They must have followed the taxi, it's such a gap though between him getting there and what was going on.
Yeah, another plot hole, but then you wouldn't get the movie without it.
And there we go.
Yeah. And then, so she tells him that she's moving and all this sort of stuff. Oh, and the place is on fire. Oh, we forgot to mention, this is one of those movies that begins at the end.
Yes.
And has the fire brigade and everything going on, and that's the beginning, and then obviously we see how we get to that point. I don't know how new that sort of concept was in those days. I don't know if it was used that often, but it was an interesting concept. Mm-hmm. I'm sure it was used before, but it was interesting. It was always the plan, apparently. I was listening again in the commentary. They were talking about it, and someone asked the question. The commentary is really good. There's about three commentaries on the Blu-ray, and the one I listened to is Sigrid Thornton and the director and a few of the other people. It's really interesting that they talk about. And one of them just asks if that was the case, that it was tagged on. Did they do it in editing or was it always the plan? Apparently, it's always the plan to have the end at the beginning sort of thing. So, so Daryl turns up and wants to take her away from everything, of course, and doesn't want to let her go. And they have a nice little struggle in a laneway. And all of a sudden, he gets run over by his weepy van.
What a way to go.
What a way to go. And gets basically driven into a wall, I think. It's not very very gory, but.
No, but it was a shock, though, because I did not see that coming.
Yeah, it came out of nowhere, right?
It was like, maybe my dream is coming true. Maybe it was the van the whole time.
And guess who was driving the Mr. Whippy van, Annette?
It was me. Little. It was her the whole time.
she gets out of the Mr. Whippy van, and of course, Angela's pretty happy about this. I don't have a weird stalker anymore. I don't have an ex-boyfriend anymore. He's gone.
What was skipped there when it was in the midst of the fire and Angela didn't want to be seen by everybody.
That's
and
right.
She did going off with Daryl.
That's right.
Mads did turn up. And I don't know if you noticed, she was screaming for Angela, not her husband.
She was. Yeah, that's right. Yes, exactly.
So it's like,
yeah. Yeah.
I'm just thinking there's more. But yeah, and when she popped out of that van, it was like, no.
Yeah, I wonder. There you got me thinking. I wonder if it was her plan all along to be in cahoots with a husband to a point and then use it to her. But then how would she know that Angela was going to get out of a burning place on her own as well? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Again, the plot holes. I mean.
Yeah. Like I said, written in 4 days. But yeah, so they go off together. I think, did I see it right, that she was going to go with her?
Yeah, they were going to go off to Fiji together.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, so.
So then was the job a whole set up because she knew that guy with the moustache in the office? Was it for her all along? But you could just,
Yeah, I don't know. Or she could have stayed put and just had a modelling career. Who knows?
Who knows?
It's really weird.
I want a sequel now.
I do. Snapshot 2. Get ready to get gaslit again. She could have got together with, what's the photographer's name again? Lindsay?
Yeah.
She could have. I don't think he had a thing for anyone, but.
No.
He was very much his own person. Inside his own little world in his head. But yeah, so they go off and live happily ever after, I guess. Even the end titles are unsettling. In the end titles, you've got like the really heavy music and then these shots of Angela that the guy has just taken before he burnt to death. And she looks really vulnerable and all this. And it doesn't even end on a nice note because the last note is thing at the end. And
I know. I mean, because there was a scene we didn't talk about where obviously it was when Mads came out to Angela that she was gay and that she was attracted to her. And obviously Angela wasn't into it, but it was the only time when someone respectfully out of everyone that was just after this girl.
Yeah. Yeah.
Respectfully stood back and it was like, it was really nice. It's like, we can carry on being friends and it doesn't have to be weird. And it was all lovely. But then you have this, and it's like, you're a little bit dangerous, man. You're a bit cuckoo for cocoa puffs. What are you doing?
She just killed a guy.
Happily ever after in Fiji.
Yeah. I don't think when they make these movies in these days, I don't think they think much about, especially these movies like cost $300,000 and they're just there to make a few dollars for them and whatnot.
Yeah, and of course.
They don't think.
It's Friday, Saturday night movie fodder, isn't it?
It is. It's the day after Halloween. Oh, it's a strange one. But it's actually, so for me, I think it's an enjoyable movie, though. I enjoyed it.
I'm not going to lie. I enjoyed it as well.
Yeah, it's quite enjoyable. The acting's okay. There's no really bad acting in the whole thing. It's all pretty well done. It's nicely shot. Locations are interesting. It's all shot in Melbourne. And, yeah, it's just those questions. I'll just never get over the pig's head and work it.
We will solve it one day, Pete. We will do it.
Do you know what it reminded me of? When she came home and that it looked like someone else was in her bed. I once was traveling for work and was booked into a hotel and was checked in, given the room key and everything, opened the door in the room and there was someone in the bed. And they checked me into the wrong room. It's so strange. This is back in like the early 90s, I think it happened. It's so weird.
Oh, my God.
So strange. Yeah, it's weird. I just shut the door quietly. Went back and said,
gonna back out.
I think you've given me the wrong room.
Oh, my God. You could have been anybody.
I know.
They could have been anyone in there. Oh, my God.
Security, right?
Yeah.
How weird. I'm surprised the person in the bed didn't even stir. They could have been dead for all I knew. There was no smell, so I assume they were right. But yeah, it was crazy anyway. The other thing I wanted to mention about this movie is a lot of the people in the production side and the film side of this came from TV. They all work for what's known as Crawford Productions in Melbourne. So at the time, they were shooting Matlock and Homicide, and they're all like cop shows, right? And a lot of the team came from that, and there was a lot of talk about that on the commentary, and just a lot of in general. There's a lot of these people that all made their mark in TV. I think Sigrid Thornton was on TV very early as well, working for Crawford Productions.
She did stuff like The Sullivans,
exactly. That was Crawford. Yeah.
Yeah. And
did you ever see The Sullivans? Did it ever air over there?
It did. I very vaguely remember. It's always The Sullivans and Sons and Daughters, the theme tunes are very much from my childhood.
Oh, really? Sons and Daughters. Wow, that's a callback. What's the other one? Country Practice was the other one.
Oh, yeah. Flying Doctors.
God, you got all the Australian shows, didn't you?
Of course,
you got Neighbours, right? You guys went nuts for Neighbours.
Neighbours and Home and Away. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, like I watched all like the kids shows as well. I don't know if you're the Henderson Kid, Pugwall Summer.
Around the Twist.
Yeah.
It's crazy. It's interesting. Interesting TV that goes between Australia and the UK.
I tell you, one of my all-time favourites, I'm going off track here, but I don't know if you remember. It was a comedy from the early 90s and it was Let the Blood Run Free.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was obsessed. It used to be on at like 1 a.m, so I'd be like, I'm supposed to be getting up for school, but like, no, I'm going to stay. I'm going to stay awake. Yeah.
So any final thoughts on this film?
I'm going to say, I don't know from our description whether somebody would willingly going to watch this if they've listened to us first. But what I will say is, honestly, it's so bizarre and wonderful and obviously problematic to a modern audience, but also nostalgic, and you have to let stuff go to a certain extent. Just enjoy the ride of what this crazy ice cream truck of a movie is.
It is. I definitely would. I'd actually recommend watching it if you can get hold of it.
Or
just check it out on Prime if you're in Australia or Broly or something like that. It's definitely worth a watch.
I have to admit, I'm funny with, because there's such a certain intensity with a lot of Australian cinema that I get nervous watching them sometimes that it's going to be too much. And this is just from that kind of era where there is a lot of like sexual references and things like that. I can't watch like Rape Revenge and things like that. It's not my thing.
Right.
And I have an intrepidation when it goes into stepping into that kind of, because a lot of that was very obviously prevalent in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah.
But this actually, because when you read the synopsis, oh God, the nudity is happening, there'll be other things. But no, it's involved, but it's not explicit. There's nothing really explicit about this movie, which I appreciated on that point for myself personally.
Yeah, it's not.
You get one hairy bum shot and a pair of boobs and that's it.
Yeah, you get the boobs, I think. What was the hairy bum shot?
There was a bit where Mads and Angela go back to the house and there's two people having sex on the floor and you just get one shot of the guy's hairy bum.
Forget that.
You probably mentally blocked it out for your own safety, Pete. Yeah.
Interesting. But anyway, yeah, it's interesting. It's not too problematic. I know a lot of the films we cover here are quite problematic just because of the era more than anything.
Yeah, I think there's certain language that you have to excuse. There's one or two phrases like, but you just move on from
it. It's I've had some of the movies I've done before, there's stuff in it that you'd call quite racist and that sort of stuff. But it's hard. There's this whole conversation to be had, I think, about separating the what is acceptable today from what was made 40 or 50 years ago in film. Because I really hate this I think the recent one I heard is like there was it on Disney Plus, they had The French Connection, the movie The French Connection, and they cut pieces out of it recently.
Really?
Because they didn't think it was fit today's. And I'm like, why do that? Why do that? Why not just have a little piece at the start of the movie just saying, hey, things depicted in this movie we understand aren't acceptable these days, but it was made of this time, blah, blah, blah. I think I have a disclaimer like that on the bottom of my notes for my podcast every episode that basically just says, I mean, like, some of the subjects we cover are not something it would be acceptable today, but it's just it's because of the time they were made, right?
Exactly. You've got to think of it in its own time capsule, and you can't put your modern sensibilities on something that, like you said, was created that long ago.
Yeah.
So if you are okay to do that, to compartmentalize it for yourself, go ahead and enjoy it. If you can't do that,
just don't watch that, it.
Maybe then, it's not for you, and don't put yourself in that position.
Yeah, exactly. And don't tell everyone else they can't watch it. I'm sorry, but I had to say, it's like, just don't watch it, right? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. There are certain, like I said, when it comes to like rape revenge movies, they are not for me. I know that I'm just not going to watch those, and that's fine. People want to watch them. That's their business. And I'm not going to judge anyone or anything, because the stuff I watch that they will, I mean, crikey, I've watched Real Housewives before, and I don't expect people to judge me and not talk to me, I guess. I hope.
Yeah, it's
because she watched Real Housewives. I've shot myself in the foot.
Real Housewives.
I just do it because I like to laugh.
That's right. I mean, look, every year I say I'm not going to watch it, but my wife always, for some reason, watches Married at First Sight. I don't know if you have that show over there, but anyway.
Yeah, I know that one, yeah.
And I always say this is a load of shit, and she knows it is too, and she watches it, I think, for the same reason. And eventually what will happen a bit further down the track in the season, we'll sit together and we'll be watching it or something like that, and I'll go, oh, this is shit. But then I end up starting to make comments about different people and, oh, I can't believe they did that. And I'm like, oh, shit, I'm into it. What's going on?
It's only about the drama. I don't care about the rest.
It's crazy.
It's just the drama.
I still reckon they plant actors in those shows. But
oh, yeah, they have 100%.
Anyway, so that was Snapshot, and it was a fun watch for all, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I appreciate you letting me watch this with you, Pete. I really did enjoy it.
It was
honestly
fun. It was fun. As we close up, so give us a bit of an idea what's happening with you, where people can find you.
Oh, gosh, yes. I'm on two podcasts. Thank you very much. Two different podcasts.
Don't know how you find time.
If I could squeeze it in. Yeah. I'm on Stiletto Banshees with Tab and Micah that you've had on the show before. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got some more recording to do. And I think there's going to be a couple of more releases coming very shortly, I hope. Obviously, there is an Instagram page for Stiletto Banshees as well, if you want to have a look there at bits and bobs we've done or we'll be doing. And my main podcast is Two Crones and a Book, which I host with my friend from childhood, Michelle. We've known each other since the first day of primary school.
You can tell.
Yeah. Yeah, and we mainly started to discuss books in the horror genre, and we also, as well as review books, we have ramble episodes where we'll be posed a question. It started off book related, but it stretched out to just different things where we just go off and have such an absolute giggle. They're really fun to make, and it's a really good laugh. And we're broadening our book spectrum as we're going into. We've just come out of our second year now, so we're really enjoying ourselves. Okay. So, yeah, it's a lot of fun. And you can find us on TikTok. Tab makes us these brilliant little audiograms.
Yeah, they're awesome. I love seeing those. I see them in TikTok all the time.
Yeah. Well, Tab puts those together for us. So she just takes clips of episodes to give you an idea of what we're about. And they're just so funny. She puts in little images to go along with it. They're so funny.
They're great.
But yeah, we're on TikTok at Two Crones and a Book. We're also on Instagram at Two Crones and a Book. And there is a Facebook page, but that's not as lively as it used to be. But I still throw in the audiograms, and If we see an occasional thing we find funny, we'll pop it on there as well. So yeah, just check us out. We're on all platforms. If anyone wants to interact, we absolutely love interaction with listeners. It just makes our day completely.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. It's really good. I've listened to a couple of episodes. I must say I haven't listened to all of them, but the TikToks are amazing. They're really funny. Because I'll hear one of those, I go, oh, I need to listen to that episode. It sounds like a lot of fun. So they're doing their job.
Fantastic. Oh, yeah. Pete. Oh, you've made my day.
Anyway, thank you so much for coming on, Annette. It was a ball. I had a great time. It was really good. And I'll definitely have you back for sure. We'll have to do something. I've got a heap to do this year. I only did 9 episodes, I think, last year. I really need to catch up this year. I want to get to my 50th episode this year if I can.
Oh, wow.
How hard is it to get to 50? Just to get to 20
was crazy.
Tough. It's nuts anyway.
Yeah.
It's all good. All right. Thank you so much. And when we come back, I'll talk about what's coming up next.
And now, preview time. When it comes to entertainment, you can't beat a good film. So let's take a look at what's coming your way.
Next on A Dingo Ate My Movie, I'm joined by Matt Fulton to talk about the Alvin Purple double, Alvin Purple and Alvin Rides Again. Thanks for taking the time to listen to this episode. Thank you to all my guests who give their time to make this podcast possible, and a special thanks to you for listening. Don't forget, you can follow A Dingo Ate My Movie on social media. We're at Dingo Movie on Twitter, Dingo Movie Pod on Facebook and Instagram, and on the web at dingomoviepod.com. Once again, thanks for listening, stay safe, and I'll see you on the next episode of A Dingo Ate My Movie.